Hello，大家早上好，我的短发又回来啦。很多人开始 follow 我都是从我短发时期吧，然后虽然留长过这么一段时间，可是我还是觉得短发比较适合我。然后现在这个造型呢，就是我刚刚起床没多久，然后就没有打理过它的，就是一个很自然的起床的一个造型。对，然后就是当然形状没有昨天这么好看，可是我觉得 overall 还是可以的吧，就是对于一个上班上学来讲还是很方便的，你起床就差不多梳梳就可以走了。当然了，就是等它过几个小时之后，可能形状会更加自然一点。那我等会儿呢要出去做这个健身，然后现在还有大概半个小时的时间，现在是8:36，我9点钟要出门。然后现在打算做一个雅思口语的示范。我知道我很久没有发过这个示范了，然后你们催得我头发都快掉了，所以我今天早上就趁这个时间空隙做一个示范。那跟之前一样会做这个盲选题目。然后这个视频呢会是一个无剪辑的视频，因为这样子才会比较，怎么说，真实的还原吧。OK，我们就用这个题库，1到4月份的题库。然后我现在来盲选。OK，我们做这个失而复得的东西。他说，Describe an occasion when you lost something and then got it back. You should say what you lost, how you lost it, where you found it, and how you felt about it. OK，失而复得的东西。好，那我们现在开始。那这个视频呢是无剪辑的。OK，好。但是我讲的时候可能会看一下这个题卡，因为我想就是 kind of remind myself of what's in the topic。All right。Okay, actually, to be quite honest, I regard myself as a very prudent person. I seldom lose things, right? I usually take my things with me, and I always pay attention to if my things are still there. But one time that I did lose something was about 4 or 5 years ago. I think it's definitely 5 years ago. 5 years ago, right? So I was on a date with my boyfriend, and I think it was our, you know, fifth or sixth date, and it was also the first time that we left downtown. We went to a pretty, you know, remote place in Hong Kong, in a small corner in Hong Kong called Stanley. And Stanley is a beachside town, right? Beachside area. Very pretty, gorgeous scenery and beautiful landscape. And we spend the day there feeling very happy, blissful, and you know, all kinds of rosy emotions. So at night, we're about to head back to downtown to have dinner, right? And we took the bus. It was a double-decker bus. So as you know, all the buses in Hong Kong basically double-decker. And we sit on the top deck, right? Because on the top deck, you could see more scenery, right? It was ro more romantic and also kind of more isolated in a way. So we're sitting on the top deck, and I was telling my boyfriend about my childhood. And in my wallet, there was this picture of me as a kindergarten kid, right? So I showed the picture to him. And then at the time, I didn't remember if I put my wallet back, but somehow I just, you know, put it aside. And then we reached our destination, so we got off, right? So we had dinner. And it was not until after dinner that I realized I lost my wallet. So I was truly trying to search, probing into my memory about where I put my wallet. And then I realized I might have put my wallet on the bus, right? Just on the seat where I sat. So at first I was really panicky because in my wallet there were all sorts of important documents, you know, my ID card, my bank cards, my credit cards, my staff card, all kinds of important documents, not to mention, you know, money inside, right? So I couldn't start to imagine the painful process of getting all those documents back. Losing money is just a small thing, but getting the documents back, oh my God, I can't imagine. So after a while, I started to calm down, and then because we got off not at a terminal, so my first instinct was to go to the terminal, right, to see if the bus was still there. But it was quite unlikely because it was already like 2 hours after I got off. But anyhow, I went to the bus terminal, and then at every bus terminal in Hong Kong, there was this security guard there, right, who's responsible to, you know, to inspect the buses and in charge of any lost and found. So I went there, I talked to the security guard, and he asked me a few questions about which route I took, and I told him everything. And then he called the person in charge of the route of the bus, right? And then after a few conversations, they actually got my wallet. My wallet was still there. in the same bus, on the same seat. I was completely amazed, right? Because I didn't realize, I didn't know that I could actually get it back, right? So this incident just made me feel really grateful that, you know, people in Hong Kong are, in general, they're actually quite kind and they're responsible and they're quite civilized, because when they see things that don't belong to them, they usually hand it over to people in charge. This also happened a few times to my other friends. They lost something, they forgot their thing somewhere, but then eventually they could get it back. So I was really appreciative of people's kindness and people's self-control. When they see things that don't belong to them, they actually leave it alone or hand it over to people in charge. So that was my experience. Okay, 那刚刚那个部分呢，五分五十五秒是无剪辑的。我现在来分析一下，我们怎么样去处理这样子的一种回忆类型的题目。其实呢，我跟我很多学生也说过，很多雅思题目到最后都是在讲故事。 It's all about storytelling, right? 讲故事，你要怎么样把你发生在你自己或你朋友身上的一个故事可以比较声情并茂的，在这么短时间内声情并茂的跟那个考官说出来，让他有一个视觉化的感觉，仿佛他在看一场电影，一个短视频，一个电影，就是去体验一下你的经历。所以呢，在讲故事的时候，我们所谓的几大要素嘛，时间、地点、人物、事件，对吧，这种四大要素，然后起因、经过、什么发展结果，这个是蛮重要的， right? 所以最开始我讲那部分就是跟我男朋友约会那部分，虽然对整个故事来讲不是特别的，对整个话题来讲不是特别的相关，可是呢，它可以帮助我们去带入到后面那半部分的故事，我们可以体会到一种心情的反差，开始是很 happy 啊，就是很 carefree 啊，然后突然之间 oh my god, my wallet was lost, right? 这种感觉。所以有时候有一些必要的一些 extra 的 information 我觉得是可以讲的。而且雅思你看它的那个考试评分标准，它没有一项是评论你是否是 entirely on topic, 它评论的是你的 coherence,你是否连贯，你的故事结构是否连贯，是否有条理，它没有评论你是否可以 off topic。并且我看过好几个雅思的分析视频，都有讲过，其实我们讲雅思这个口语是可以 off topic 的， at some part 你是可以 off topic, 不过最后你还是要回来，对吧？最后你要回归到这个题目它自己本身的一个要求。那所以呢，大家在讲故事的时候，你可以想想有什么样的细节讲出来是可以渲染一下这个气氛啊，或是让那个考官，让一个陌生人可以更加理解到你讲这个故事的一个内容，这样子的， right?那这就是一个分析。大家真的，你要想讲好雅思 Part 2的话，一定要去 work on 你的 storytelling techniques。 OK, 好，我现在差不多要出门了，43分啦，那我们就下个视频再见啦。